weekend and yesterday's class as well. So let's continue. And you know, the whole idea for the yesterday's class was about, you know, getting to giving a good introduction about how the software development works in the industrial standards these days. Be it not necessarily if it is a data science application or not, but in general, whenever you build a software and you are looking for good practices, you might have learned about some of the new some of the models that are used, for example, water flow model, and there are a lot of them actually. So that was the whole idea of, you know, yesterday's class. So yeah, so guys, just please feel free to interrupt me whenever you have any questions. So that again, you know, just take a pause and answer your question. And yeah, so that was about yesterday. So today we'll start with the the whole outline of the course, what we'll be dealing with, not in the absolute granular details, but at least on an overall perspective, what we'll be learning at the end of this course. And then we'll start with the introduction about Python. That's more of a, you know, general introduction on what Python is and when do we use it and when not use it, and a couple of other applications of Python, and you know, the basic installation of Python as well as in the software that we'll be going through throughout our course. So yeah, let's get started then. Okay, yeah. So, you know, this is just the topics on an overall perspective on what we'll be doing. We'll start with the introduction on what Python is basically, and a few things related to installation. And that basically would be your, I'll give you the steps basically, and that will be your assignment to complete the installation, because it's just like a couple of clicks away, nothing more than that. So that shouldn't be a problem. And I will point you to the respective links where you need to download and all those things. We'll start with, then we'll go through the simple Hello World application. You know, that's, be it any programming language, that's the first baby step that you take. So, and then we'll discuss about variables, operators that are, you know, used in Python, and then how you make the decision making things like the if else statements and how do you write those statements. And, you know, on an overall perspective, the flavor of the entire session of the next 6 weeks is going to be about, you know, first getting introduced with Python, having said that about the introduction about and the introduction about Python, it doesn't mean that you need to have a knowledge on programming or anything. So that's why we start with the basic programming stuff, and that has nothing to do with data science. Let me be very clear on that. So that is just as a language, how to use Python. Then we'll move on to the statistic related things, which are like the, you know, the fuel for your data science applications or the machine learning. That's where we'll move, and then we'll have a couple of use cases that we'll be working on to see how we can use that application into any of the real business use case. And we'll also, you know, time and again, you know, I do that actually with a lot of students in my batches that I've conducted earlier. I'll be giving you some of the use cases that I have actually worked on. So that would, you know, especially for today's session, for example, it might be a little bit of theoretical because we're just getting introduced to a new language. So, you know, just to spice that up, I'll give you, you know, like a use case that I worked on and how that use case solved a problem. The reason why I do that is, being a data scientist at the end of this course, one of the major requirement or a qualification that a data scientist need is, how do you understand the business and how do you come up with a solution that will solve your problem? So in that, you need to keep your thinking in such a way that you need to understand what kind of data do you have, what can you do with that data, and if done in the right way, what can it solve for you? That's very important, because it doesn't happen always. I mean, as of I always advise to keep a long-term vision. It's not that like in 6 months down the line, I need to finish up this project. That's not the thing. Think about 4 or 5 years from now. You will be in a situation where you need to think about how do you solve a problem from the scratch. In fact, how do you create a situation where you have something to solve for, so that you can present it to someone and explain why a data science or a machine learning application would be useful there. So that's where we'll go. time and again, you know, I'll pick up a couple of use cases from my experience and give you some of the details. Obviously, that will not be a practical hands-on use cases because developing that will take a lot of time. But still, giving you an idea and, you know, mentoring you in getting a analytical thinking is what the core idea is there. Okay. So yeah, coming back to the topics that we'll be discussing. So from there, we'll go to the basic data structures that Python has, be it a list, tuples, or dictionary. You know, don't worry, we'll discuss this in detail. You'll come to know how these are different from each other and which one to use when and all those things. Then we'll move on to the modules or the functions part of Python that is there. It's, you know, quite, it's there in most of the programming languages. It's just the how you use it in Python. That's something which is quite significant there, how you use it in a different way. That's pretty much it there. And with respect to the exceptions and the OOPS concept, OOPS being just the object-oriented programming. So yeah, we'll discuss about that. And then we'll move on to some of the regular expressions that Python provides that, you know, sometimes it comes in very handy when you're trying to look for some of the words or something in the, especially when it comes to a natural language, an NLP kind of a problem. NLP as in the natural language processing that you do. You know, a quick, just to give you, give you an idea what exactly is meant by a natural language processing is, like, let's say there is some event that's happening. For example, let's say the US election. So there was a, so during the campaigns and during the entire course of election, people used to tweet about, okay, so am I not audible, guys? Guys, am I audible properly? Oh, is there anyone who is having any trouble in hearing me? Just, you know, drop a message. Okay, I guess I'm audible at all the places. May that may be just a temporary glitch that might have happened. Oh, okay, okay. Thank you guys. Yeah. So let's move on. Yeah. So where was I? I was just telling you, you know, one of the use cases. This is what I'll do actually throughout the course, like I was telling you. I'll pick on a couple of use cases to give you the real-time examples and how you can use it. So when I say about the natural language processing, that basically, you know, it's a very simple thing. So let's assume you are, you know, sitting at work and you think of, let's see what is the sentiment of the people in sentiment towards who will win the election. Will it be Trump or Clinton? You know, who is going to win the election? You want to see, you have your own opinion. Let's say you're supporting Trump. You have your own opinion. Yes, you know, there's every right that you have your opinion. Nobody can question that, obviously. But let's say you want to see or do a survey on how the trend is among the people. So generally what people do is they do some tweeting. They will tweet whatever they are, you know, wishing to, as in the sentiment that, you know, this is what Trump did like 4 years ago. It's not something good that that he will be a president. It might not be good for the country. Or maybe he says that, you know, Trump has been a great guy, done a lot of development in US, and it could be a great thing. Similar to Clinton and so on. You have many different tweets, like millions of tweets, you know, flowing in the last weeks of campaigning that's going on before the elections. You have a lot of tweets there. Now it's, you know, basically not possible for you sitting down there and analyzing all the tweets just by seeing them and understanding whether what is the majority of the population going towards. Is it that the people are having more support for Trump or for Clinton? Now what you do there is you basically take, let's say you took 10,000 tweets from somewhere. You know, it's quite easy these days. You, if you want to note down, there's an Twitter actually provides his own APIs so that developers do not have any difficulty in getting those tweets. So that's one of things is called as Flume, if I'm not wrong. Flume was the name. Yeah, that was Flume. So Flume, it has an APIs with respect to Flume, where you can, you know, just use them and get all the tweets. That will be based on whatever handle you're using and the respective keywords that are there in the tweet. It will get you all the tweets, you know, just a matter of seconds, that is, these days. So that shouldn't be a problem. So now, once you have the tweets, let's say you have 1,000 odd tweets now. Now, what do you do with them? You just basically go through a few of them and you understand what your sentiment is, or what you understand is that by reading them, you say that, yeah, this is a positive tweet and this is a negative tweet. Meaning, let's say we'll simplify the problem even more. Let's not compare, Trump and Clinton also. Let's say only about Trump. If a tweet is positive, in a positive sentiment about Trump, let's call it one. And if it is not, let's call it zero. So what do we have at the end of the day? Like 1,000 odd tweets. You need to first, you know, label your data, or as in tell the data that what kind of data is it. Going on to the next level, these days you don't have to do that also. You have APIs which will just understand the sentiment. There are built models that are there which will just take your data and it will have the sentiment analysis already run. You just feed your tweet and it'll give you the result. But I'll prefer, you know, not to use that in the first step itself. So basically you have 1,000 odd tweets, you label them. This is a positive one, this is a negative zero. Now you have a data set. Given a tweet that whenever someone is saying some positive things, that's one. So it has got a trend. For example, there is a word that's there, you know, good development kind of a thing. Then you know that it's talking positive about Trump. And in the other sentence, it's saying something about, let's say, corruption or something of that sort. Yeah, it's a negative thing about them. Once you have that kind of classifier, you don't have to do anything. You get 1 million tweets. All you need to do is pass it through that model and get the data, the tweets data, into the model, and it will give you 1 and 0 for that. Just imagine if you have over 80-90% accuracy in such a model. You don't have to do anything. You didn't just spend a couple of hours in building a model, getting the tweets that you had, and built a model out of it. Now you can anytime use the same tweet just to understand the sentiment about anything, be it Trump or Clinton, or be it any other election, or be it the decision about Brexit, whether it should happen or not. What is the people's sentiment? Do they feel good? Do they not feel good? What is the sentiment about people? So these kind of classifiers, once built, you can use it in the next steps or next different kind of problems, basically. So that's just an example of natural language processing. You know, if you have a little bit difficulty in what exactly, you know, is NLP and how do we get the words, how do we understand to build whether it is one or zero, you know, leave those details to the further sessions. We'll go in detail. But what the reason why I'm telling you is just get an understanding of what kind of problems can be solved by machine learning. That is a very important aspect of here. It's not that you can solve each and everything. There is a limitation. There is a saturation for everything. I'm sorry, saturation would not be the right word. There's a limit for everything. As in, it's not that everything can be solved, but you should understand how you can formulate the problem in solving it. So that's one of the use cases. Now, you know, if you have an English kind of a natural language kind of a data. Okay. So Binish is asking, how can you use the same tweet for other people? Now, by the same tweet, what I mean is, if you have a similar scenario, let's say in the first case when we did it with case of Trump. Whenever we see anything related to Trump, someone did a hashtag Trump, I know that I'm going to fetch all the tweets with respect to Trump and do a sentiment analysis on that. For example, next time what happened was it was with respect to Brexit. Now, all you need to do is get the data on tweets on Brexit. You can understand whether the sentiment is positive or not. What is the tone of the person? You know, consider it as in if someone is asked saying something, you can make out by the tone of the person that whether it is he's asking a question or he's telling me a statement. The same thing happens when you're writing also. When you're writing something, you can understand whether it is going in a positive direction. Is it praising the person or the decision or in an action, or is it against that? That way, a sentiment thing can be reused. But it doesn't mean that it can be whenever you build it for the scenario that I explained, you can use it for anything with respect to tweet. But there are similarities. So Binish, does that answer your question? Okay, cool. Thank you. Yeah, so that's one of the example. Now you know, yes, if I have English kind of data, I can create some analytics or sense out of the data with a machine. I need to just build a model. I can use it wherever I want to. That's one example. I'll you know, at the end of the session, I'll give you one more interesting example. I'll just note it down. Just in case I forget, please remind me that. That's a very interesting. I'll tell you how we can use the same concept in different scenarios. Yeah. So that's about, you know, regular expressions and natural language that we'll be dealing with. Next, we'll, you know, go to the basic statistics that we need. That's where, you know, this is the part where we'll jump into all the things that you need, all, you know, just getting your webinar ready for data science and machine learning. So you'll learn about all the statistics and few of the libraries that Python provides with respect to be it NumPy, Pandas, or XYZ, SciPy, Matplotlib, Seaborn. There are many, many more, but, you know, honestly speaking, it's not possible to cover each and everything. So we pick up a few of them which are very, you know, very heftily used. We use them, and then we give you an idea on how you can you know, just research about other algorithms as well and learn how you can use that. So that's what we'll do there. So these are some basic libraries that used to pivot the data in one form to another, how to visualize the data, and all those things. We'll use these libraries there. Then we'll, you know, jump into a basics of probabilities, and then we'll get the introduction to the machine learning algorithms on what machine learning is basically, because there are many types of machine learning, supervised, unsupervised, reinforcement, and, you know, I can talk hours on that. So there are a lot of things. So just one topic itself covers a hell lot of things. So I've just, you know, I was making the topic, so I just cut it short with one word itself. Then we'll discuss about few of the ML algorithms that are there in, you know, trendingly used these days. You might have heard these words from people who use these machine learning algorithms. They say, I have built an SVM classifier, I built a random forest classifier, and this, that. What exactly are these? What is SVM? What is random forest? What is boosting? We learn about all those things there. From there, we'll move on to some of the concepts with respect to Spark. So Spark is basically a concept in the big data world. So one of the core reason why I'll be focusing on Spark is that the amount of data that's there in today's industry with everyone is, you know, to be honest, is going out of control now. At one point, the even a small machine, if you want to capture, not a machine, let's say a simple car also, if you start capturing the data that it produces in a minute, it will easily cross your few GBs, few gigabytes will be easily crossed there. On how much pressure are you applying on the accelerator, how the steering movement is going, how the road condition, there are a hell lot of things that you can do. Now based on that, I'm just giving you one small example, like as simple as a car can produce such amount of data. Now, how do you handle such data? That's where Spark comes into picture. You know, I have not added that, but I'll also, you know, give you a brief on how a big data algorithm works, how the crux of the big data algorithm is MapReduce. Now, what exactly is a MapReduce? Although I'm not included in the topics list index here, but that will cover as part of Spark on giving an understanding how a MapReduce, how as a concept does it work, because that doesn't work like a traditional programming language. That's a different programming paradigm that we need to switch to when we need to understand the MapReduce. If you say that we can write Python program using Python, we can write MapReduce using Python programming, yes, you can definitely write it. But how we write it is something very different. Yeah. So that's where we understand how a big data methodology works. And we'll use one of the libraries that Spark provides, that's MLlib, that machine learning library. So we'll just, you know, once we have the concept from the machine learning algorithm, we'll just try a couple of basic ones there in Spark and see how we can use them. Then then we'll, you know, focus a little bit on how we use those Spark libraries. So basically the point is, if you're, you know, I would advise you guys to be in, you know, just a bit in touch with the trending algorithms that are being open sourced these days. As in, there are some algorithms like, be it, let's say, a random forest. Don't worry about what a random forest does. Don't worry about it all. Just assume that there is an algorithm called random forest. Now, that algorithm is basically a concept on how it works. Now, there are different people. I mean, when I say people, not even companies, there are people who are open sourcing their own codes with different implementations of it. Now, the implementation, when it comes into picture, all it does is, using the same concept, it will make your algorithm much faster. Because let's say you were the data structures or the pattern or the code that you have written might not be efficient. As and when you improve, there are different versions of it that comes into picture. Same thing is with Spark. Spark, when it uses those algorithms, it does everything parallelly. Now, assume a job being done in a sequence way and in a parallel obviously will be much faster. But then again, training a model in parallel, it's, if you start implementing on your own, it's not even close to being a piece of cake. It's a very complicated thing when it comes to, once you understand the algorithms, you'll understand why it is even more difficult than a traditional code that you can parallelize. So we'll discuss about those things. That's why Spark comes into picture. The way it handles it, it's quite fast and has the capability of handling the quantum of data that we have these days. And then we'll do some of the, you know, just go through some basic concepts on how you can do a basic web scraping from any website, you know, get the data and you can just, you know, analyze what kind of data are there, the stop words that are there, removing and all those things. That's what we'll see. And then we'll move on to some of the projects that where we'll deal with gathering the data to cleansing, to building a model to the end. And we'll see how the entire life cycle of a data science project looks like. It could very well be a little bit different from what you have learned yesterday, you know, like from, but if you want to transform it, it's basically the same thing. Get the requirement, understand the requirements, do your coding, get your result deliverables. So basically it is almost similar, but we use different kind of words here and there, you know, you get the requirement and, you know, do the data cleansing, build your model, deploy in production and those things that happen. So that's more or less the same thing, but still there are some differences. We'll see about how we use it in practice. We will see about how we build a complete model from right from gathering data to the end solution and how do we deploy it in production as well as in just a dummy production. How we can, if we have this model, what we can do. So we'll see about all those things. So are there any questions at this moment? Okay, I guess not. Okay, let's move on now. So yeah, for today we'll discuss about why, we'll start with Python. As I told you, it's basically kind of a three-phased session, the entire 6 weeks. So first Python, then some statistics and some basic concepts, then the hands-on that we do. So that's how it will go. So first let's understand what basically is Python. First of all, forget about Python. Why do we need any programming language? So some of you, which, you know, based on the introduction that I did on Friday, I got to know that, you know, some people are already doing some coding with respect to, be it with respect to statistics or be it with respect to Python or R or be it a normal software programming as well. But the point is, why do we need it? So the thing is, systems or the machines solve your problem in a much better and efficient way than what a human can do. We do not expect a machine to create human errors, and hence the name human error. Once you're reading something, you might make a mistake, that's human error, but you don't expect such a thing from machine. That's why we need machines to do our things. We can communicate with the machines in whatever way we want, and that's why programming is just a way of doing that. It's as good as a language. I'm talking in English now. I can start talking in any other language. That's the whole difference. But what I'm conveying to you is still the same. So that's what is programming all about. Obviously, it's very hard to interact with a computer in 0 and 1, because whatever coding you do, internally, it gets transformed into a binary sequences. A machine doesn't understand anything else other than zeros and ones. So everything gets transformed. If just imagine how you do a coding in zero and one. You really can't do that, right? So, and hence we use programming languages to basically get a good idea and, you know, so that we can interact with computer in our own way, and it gets transformed by their interpreters and all those things, obviously, to communicate and simplify things. So I'll also tell you one fun fact here there with respect to programming language. Once I give an introduction about Python, we'll discuss about that as well. There's one very interesting programming language which I'm sure you might not have heard about that. So we'll discuss about that. First, let's go to Python. So yeah, I'm assuming there are no questions at this moment, but still, if anyone has one, you know, feel free to interrupt. And I'm sure you guys have the access to mics, shouldn't be a problem. But in case you don't have, you can just ping me as well. So I'll just take up your questions. And, you know, please try to open up. That will be more beneficial, as in it might well happen that you have a doubt, but someone else is thinking of asking this, but being a bit of a, you know, shying away and not asking that doubt. So it will help everyone. Okay. So yeah, Python was actually created by Guido van Rossum. It was, you know, if you read about this, you will come to know that this was basically a holiday break kind of a thing that was taken by Van when he just started, you know, thought about building a programming language. He had a holiday break. He said, you know, just might as well do something for fun, and he ended up building Python language. So that's where it started long time back. Now, one of the advantage of using Python. See, one thing obviously is that the goal of learning Python is basically to use it in data science and machine learning applications. But then why Python? There are many languages, R, some of you have already used. So that's a very valid question. And why do I use Python compared to R when I already know R? Secondly, why not? If it is a programming language, I can write the entire code in Java or C++ also. Nobody is stopping you from doing that. And as a matter of fact, I'll tell you one fact here. Most of the open sourced machine learning algorithms are internally written into C++. Reason, it is fast. Any day, a language like Python or Java cannot beat C++. It cannot happen. C++, being a very low language, hence has a little difficult, not, I would not say difficult, but comparatively, when you compare it with Python kind of a language, it's a little difficult to understand and write. When the concepts of pointers, double pointers, dangling pointers, and memory addresses that you deal with, it becomes quite complicated there. So I don't remember whom, but I remember someone was at least told me that there was he or she was a good C++ programmer. Then you'll start to feel that once you learn Python. I'm forgetting who was that, but once you see that, you will get to know that, you know, how efficient and how convenient it is to write Python, especially who knows C++. It's like a wonderland at one point, you know, the ease with which you can implement. Now, why we use Python is, the reason is the about the open source community and the easy accessibility of the functions that you need for machine learning. Obviously, you can implement those functions in any other language, wouldn't harm you in any way, but why do you sit down and implement each and everything once you have something readily available? Hence, Python and R are becoming a lot trending these days compared to any other language. But honestly speaking, I myself have implemented a machine learning algorithm using C++. I myself have done that. So it's possible. I can assure you that. It doesn't matter if, then in that case, I had to write a lot of custom functions on each and every small thing, because C++ is not meant for such a purpose. I had to do that. You know, let's not get into why I had to do such a stupid thing. But yes, that's possible is my point. So yeah, that is also there. So now that's why we come to Python on with respect to anything with respect to data science. Okay, yeah, there we have. Vinish was a one. She was into C++, and yeah, it's complex. I agree with Vinish. It is definitely. So yeah. So yeah, then we come to Python. One of the advantage of Python, it's interpretable language. By interpretable, I do not mean that you can see and understand it. By no means I mean that. What it means is, there are two kinds of languages in today's world. One is a compiled language, one is an interpreted language. What's the difference? We'll see in the next slide. But what that essentially means is, we'll see about the entire differences, what are there. But an overall perspective, what that means is, once you write your code and run it, it wouldn't be compiled till the last moment. It will just be executed and the errors will be thrown to you at the runtime. In case of compiled language, all the code is converted into a bytecode. Let's call it C++. Or in case of C++ also, you get libraries that are generated by the C++ code. And that library basically is, if I tell you in simple words, is basically the binary formats that are there. So the code has been converted to a format which is very easily understandable by computer. If you get that library to the computer, it will very quickly use that in the raw format itself. But if you give that the code, if you give the computer a code, let's say the Python code, it first needs to convert and then it needs to proceed with the execution of it. In C++, you generally have, it might not be very relevant, but I would request if you can make a note of a couple of these things with respect to interpret and compiled language. So I'm very well versed with C++. I'll take that example again and again. You get these .so, that's called the shared object files when you compile a C++ program. So there are, with C++ in Linux, you have a lot of things. You have GDP when you want to debug your code, you create these libraries and you can debug your code in that. When debugging and all this, it's there in all the language, but that's how you do it in C++ usually. So you have all those things, and the .so file, the shared object that I'm telling you, is basically something which cannot be read by a human. That's something for the machine. So that's where is the advantage. Once that code is given to the machine, it's fast. And in C++, you use pointers which points to memory addresses directly. So when you point to the memory addresses, you have the direct access. The code becomes faster and sometimes riskier as well. There are risks, as in when you try to access some of the addresses which doesn't exist, it might land into some of the crashing of your program, and there are consequences of that. In other languages like Python, you don't have to worry about those things. It's just that the system itself takes care of those things. So like in this case, Python is basically interpret. That means you don't have to compile your program before executing it. Another wonderful thing, I would say wonderful, I mean very wonderful thing, it's interactive. It's as simple as, I'll show you an example. I hope my screen is visible to everyone. All I do is type Python and I'm into a shell. I hope my screen is visible there. Just in case it's not, please, let me know. And unless I get a response there, I'm assuming that everyone is seeing my screen there. So it's as good as this. You are into the Python shell. You can do whatever you want, as in, don't worry about what code I'm writing. Just forget about just a simple one-liner code. You can write whatever code you want. You can't do that in C++ or in many other languages for that matter. When you have some simple code, as in you want to try some simple command in Python, you just go to this interactive shell, do it. You are done with it. And hence you have some softwares called IPython as well. The software installation that we do today will install the IPython as well. We use Jupyter Notebook as part of that. And you can see there, it's like a more of a visual IDE that we have. You type your commands and you'll be able to do all sorts of things. So that's one more of an advantage of Python. And this, I would call it as a myth breaker for a lot of people actually. I have from the beginning when I started working on Python, I have got this feedback that people say Python is just a scripting language. No, it's not. Python is a fully fledged object-oriented language. Anything that's capable by an object-oriented language like C++ and Java, Python is capable of doing that. But lately, the usage of Python has been into more of a scripting kind of a background. Be it the big data or the MapReduce applications, be it the data science applications. People have started, I've literally faced people who have been working for Python for quite a long time and do not know that Python is an object-oriented language. We're object-oriented, we'll discuss about all the class and objects, but it's a different concept altogether. But we'll discuss about what that means. You'll understand why we call it object-oriented, what exactly is object-oriented. But that's the scenario. A lot of people do not know about it. So this is more of a for your knowledge that it is capable of doing everything. Obviously, easy to learn, read and maintain, shouldn't face any problem. Couple of, you know, I thought of just listing down a couple of general information. Just in case, you know, you are, Chandana, was my screen not visible to you? Or I'm not really sure what that yes was for. Okay, thank you. Yeah, just to, you know, I was telling you about a fact about the programming language. I am assuming that, you know, you might have been a little bit bored because of these theory things, but I, you know, really can't help it. At the day one, when I'm introducing something, you need to start with the ground zero. So just to, you know, keep you interested, I'll tell you about one programming language. You will not believe that there exists a programming language that can be, that is, not can be, is written in just 8 characters. So all that programming language constitute is 8 characters. That is all it is. You know, just after the session, just for, you know, the fun fact kind of a thing, I'll tell you what those 8 characters are. I'm just typing it in the chat so that you can refer it later. And that's it. These are the 8 characters that gets used in the programming language. And ironically, the name is brainfuck. Just Google about it, read about the language. These 8 characters only constitute of entire programming language. You can do anything with these 8 characters. You can write a code. You can write scripts, codes, whatever you want to, basic coding that you want to do. You can do everything with just these 8 characters. So that's the name of the language. Just Google about it, you know, just as a fun fact, since we are discussing about various programming languages, just for, you know, kind of an FYI, just read about it. It's quite interesting. So yeah, that's about one of the languages that I wanted to discuss. That's one thing. Then moving on, we'll again come back to Python. So a couple of some basic, you know, info about Python. Like in C, C++, Java, usually the syntax forces you to put a semicolon at the end. In Python, that's not mandatory. So that when I say that's not mandatory, even if you put it, it's not an error, but it's something, you know, people don't prefer doing once you have, you know, it's like once you give someone a flexibility of not to flexibility of that, you know, you may choose to skip this optional step, then people generally skip that. So it's like that. So they generally don't use it, but even if you use it, it's not an error. It's not a syntax error. It's allowed. Another thing is about indentation. So I'll give you an example in today's session itself, what exactly is meant by indentation. But what it is basically is, you see all these braces, the curly braces that defines a block of a code. It's in C++ or Java or many other languages. In Python, that's not the case. All you need to do is press a tab, you get the indentation, and that's what will define the next block of code for you. All the lines following that indentation will define that particular block. So that's how you define a block of code in Python. Be it a condition, be it a function, be it a class, or a loop, or anything, we use indentation. So it's just a matter of getting used to if you have not used this. So it just after a couple of tries, you'll get used to it, how this syntax things works here. And yes, of course, look, no braces. You don't have to, you have gotten rid of those things. And that's one is especially for Binish, since I remember you are the C++ programmer. Sometimes it becomes, you know, quite hectic writing all these things. Anyways, yeah, like I told you, it's about the interpretive nature of Python. We don't have to compile a code first, we directly run it. We'll see about a simple one liner code on just a hello world code, and how what exactly is meant by that. We'll look and we'll come to know what that exactly means by interpretive and all those things. You can just enter statement in the Python in environment and they'll get executed. So this is what I mean by this. Just enter into the Python environment. Once you have installed it, you can do whatever I am doing here. You can install it and you can do just enter into the environment and do any sort of thing. So let's say a plus 5 for that matter will become 10. So yeah, that's as simple as it gets. Now, a couple of points about compiled language. Like I was telling you about two of those things, right? Basically, there are compiled language, there are interpretive languages. So let's see about what a compiled language means and how Python is different from that. Okay, I would have hoped it to come point by point, but since it has come, let's talk about it. Yeah. So yeah, in compiled languages, program is first compiled and then expressed in the instructions of target machines. Now, what this essentially means in absolute technical terms, I again take the example of C++. You write your C++ code, convert it into a shared object library, which is read by your compiler, which is read by your interpreter and executed further. Your code is converted into some format which is not human readable, and your machines understand that zero and one thing. That's what machines understand. That's what it'll do. They are generally low level programming languages. I'll just an example, let's say a plus operator that you do, it will convert to an add instruction in machine code. I'm not sure if you would have done as part of graduation course there. I'm not sure if you have done. There used to be a course on microprocessor language. Is there anyone who has done that kind of a course? Oh yes, we have Asra. So then, you know, at least you can understand the pain of writing even a two lines of code in that language. Microprocessor, it used to be MU64, MU68. I'm having a little bit of hard time in, you know, remembering that. But yeah, those assembly level languages, that is the one which, and I hope you can understand how much pain is it to write that. That is a low level language, as low as it can get. So it is as good as giving machine instructions directly, but it is too difficult to write. And hence, you know, there are high level languages. C++ is not that much low level language, but there are. But it is comparatively considered as a low level compared to the Python or those languages. So I'm not sure if you have heard of COBOL or Cobra. So COBOL is a very, very, there are still some systems which I know of in a couple of organizations which still uses Cobra. One of them was a telecom domain company which I know of in, you know, based out of US. There are people who are still using it. One of the reason is, you know, that's more of a legacy maintenance that you have to do. And, you know, they're not somehow bound that they have to use those things. So that's, let's, you know, leave it to them when they want to switch. But anyways, these are some of the things which are widely used. C++ is quite widely used till today. I'll, you know, name a couple of algorithms which I recently started working on in machine learning. They are also implemented in C++. Reason, it's fast. Not easier to write, but the speed is what gives, you know, basically overcomes or overshadows its difficult nature. Difficult as in while writing the code. That's one of the advantages of C++. And you know, any day I have a huge respect for C++ developers. That's one thing that, you know, I have learned throughout my career, honestly speaking. That's something that, you know, in Java as well, it is not that easy, but at least comparatively, the kind of IDEs, and I come from a Linux background. And writing code in a Linux system is not easy. Let me say that loud and clear. It's not easy. How you write your code, if you're following good practices, it's not easy. If you just dump your code somehow and you just go on with running it, that's okay, that you can't help it. But if you're maintaining proper code structures and all those things, so that's something which is important. And since I bring this up, so Randeep wants, if there is any particular way that you would recommend to learn C++. Okay, there was a book. Randeep, let me recollect the name. I'll get back to you latest by tomorrow. I'll tell you a book. That's one of the best book that I've come across. And you know, even that has nothing to do with data science. I would recommend people on reading that. It's more like I've noted the point. I'll get you the exact name of the book so that you can go over it. It was with the author was Scott Mayer, something like that. There was a name of the author. I'll get back to you on that and I'll tell you on what book would be useful to you there if you are very much interested. I'll note it. I'll get back to you tomorrow with the exact name of the book and if possible a PDF copy. if I have one, so that you can go through it. Yeah, and since I was telling, one thing was that effective C++, sorry, Andeep, I'm having a hard time recollecting the name. I'll publish it to everyone so that, you know, whoever wants to can go over it. Okay, and since I'm on that topic, I actually want to discuss on Friday, but you know, somehow couldn't. How many of you have a little bit of background about Unix or Linux system as well? If not, I would actually, you know, it was not a part of the course, but I'll put like one day on giving you an overall view of how Unix and Linux system works. Reason being, you know, this is a fact, and we need to admit this fact is any data science project from anywhere you pick, it is going to be 60 to 70% engineering. It's just the 30 to 40% where machine learning comes into picture. Yes, you have the idea that I want my data in such a way, that's machine learning, but how do you bring it in that way? That's coding. So coding is a very, very important part. And when you come to a stage, because, you know, like 6 weeks from now, you will be in a stage when you will be asked to write codes, build your model and put it in production system. Most of the time you'll find the system to be Linux based. If you do not have any idea on Linux system and how they work, you know, you will struggle there a bit. You will come up, I'm sure you will overcome those struggles, but it's always better to have a background on how Linux system works, the basic commands that are there in Linux. And if you have that knowledge, it will be very helpful to you. So if everyone is okay, I mean, you know, there's no problem with the course thing. I'll arrange one day. I myself will take one day course. Since we have 6 weeks, we have enough time. I'll just give one day course on how you understand the Unix system and how you write basics, you know, how we write the basic Linux commands there and how you write a basic script. So we'll go over those things as well. You know, we'll discuss about that in later also. So if anyone is specifically interested, just ping it in the chat. I'll continue the session now. And then we'll see based on the, if there are, you know, more people who are interested, we'll go over that as well. Now, one of the advantages that we have with respect to compiled languages is faster performance. Like I have been telling you from quite a long time, what C++. And the second thing is about applying optimizations during compile time. You know, just to explain this one line, it will take me like, if I'm not wrong, it will take me over an hour to how I can optimize on compile time. So just, you know, take this one as a statement that yes, something can be done, because even if I start explaining from the basics of this, it'll take a lot of time, which, you know, might not be very fruitful to us. So you can just make a peace with that for now. Now, again, when we compare it with respect to interpretive language, what we see there is we have the code, it need not be previously compiled. You can directly execute it. Now we write our code. For example, when I wrote here a is equal to 5, for example, a computer doesn't understand what is a equal to 5. What is a? It understands 5, of course, though the number he'll understand in some format. So 5 will become a binary representation in some way. Yes, it will understand that, but it doesn't understand what is a. It will assign some memory somewhere. How does it get instructions on when you say equal to 5? In the beginning part, let's say the first and the second week of the entire session, I'll focus a lot on the programming concepts only and how a compiler interprets thing, how your memory allocation happens in the heap space and all those. I'll put a lot of focus on that, because you know that's something which you need to deal with. I'll give you a very small example. Just today, while I was doing some of the coding, I'm facing some basic errors about heap error and memory error that you face into. And this is such basic errors that whenever you have even a little bit of big data, you will end up with those problems. So unless you understand these things, you won't be able to solve it very easily. So that's where I'll put a bit of more focus there as well. Now, when you see this a equal to 5, we understand this, but how does computer interpret it? It converts that into a bytecode. Now, what that bytecode contains is more of you can consider it is analogous to the shared object that I was telling in C++. When you compile, it converts into some instructions. Now that is a similar thing with bytecode. It converts into the bytecode and then passes on to the machine to execute those instructions. But that is done after you execute a code. Not, it is not needed to be separately compiled. Okay? So that's one thing with respect to interpretive languages. And like the third point, the interpreter examines the bytecode and performs the actions accordingly. Couple of examples, Python, JavaScript, Perl. Yeah, so those are the kind of languages that are generally interpretive. Now, platform independence. Now, the platform independence part is, I'll again take the example of Python and C++. And if you do C++, if you have written a code in Linux system, you cannot, let me enforce this once again, you cannot run that code on Windows machine. You cannot take that code directly and run it on Windows machine. Either there are situations where you might have to even rewrite your code. Rewrite as in make few modifications based on the platform that you're running on. But sometimes that's not needed. You know, if you're not doing such an advanced coding, that's not needed. Just the recompiling of the code and then running it will work fine. But at least you have to recompile still. With Python, you take the exact same code, write it in Linux, run it there, you'll get the output. Take the exact same code, go and run it into Windows. It will run exactly fine as you want it to be. That's platform independence for you. One of the advantages of Python that we have. Now, it can be a bit convenient for dynamic languages. That again is a very, you know, deep topic. So I'll just, you know, skip that. And then it's obviously easier to implement. As we learn Python, you'll kind of know that how easy it is to implement those things. Now we'll discuss about a few of the Python features. Does anyone have any question at this moment? I can see a few of the, you know, hands up for the Linux session. So I'll arrange something. I'll have to prepare some of the content basically. So I'll arrange something that, you know, in the beginning couple of weeks so that you have a good idea on that. So we'll do that. So I'm assuming there's no questions. Okay, let's move on. So we'll discuss about some of the Python features. We already saw we don't have compile and link. So linking is something, you know, the or I should put it this way, the pain of linking libraries that we face in C++ is no more there in Python. So linking is more like, you know, when you create some functions or some code that you've created somewhere, you write, you execute that code, the library needs to be linked when you are comparing, you know, forming a final binary or the executable. So I know it could have gone like, you know, on top of the head when I said this statement. So I'll elaborate a bit on what I meant by that exactly. So when you create any application, what you do is first you create your pieces of code in different files. When you compile that, respective libraries are created. So linking has to do with the C++ like language, which are compiled language, not the interpretive one. So when you write your code, there are codes written in different files and you have your code, you compile them, you get respective libraries. Now, how do you create an executable? Any program, for that matter, usually if you know, if the practices are followed, you will have a main function somewhere where your execution starts. So when it starts from main, so you need to have an executable which will link all those libraries into one. And basically you can consider that as a wrapper of all the libraries into one binary file. In a binary file, or you can call it as an executable file as well. Generally, when you see in C++, it's more, if by default it becomes the dot out file, you generally see that. So yeah, that's what you see in C++. So that's one thing. So those pain that you have to take while linking and when you are creating those binaries, it's, you know, much difficult, much harder done when compared to what I'm saying right now. It takes a lot of effort there generally. So that is one thing which you don't have to deal with Python. Now, no type declarations. Now, although I have not discussed about that function till now, but I'll give you an example. I hope my screen is still visible. Let's say I do again a of 5. Python has a function which defines you what is the type of a variable. So it tells me that the variable is integer. Now, let's say if I do this and execute the previous command again, it has become string. What that means is I do not have to tell the compiler that what kind of variable I'm creating. I can do phi, I can write a string, I can write a float value also, a decimal value, I can do anything. I don't have to tell the compiler what kind of variable I'm going to create. The compiler judges itself based on the RHS or the right hand side, whatever value is there, it will judge it based on that. Okay, so it's not something we have to, if you see in any programming, you have to define int A or float A or character array or string A or those things that happens. So that's what is avoided in case of Python. So you don't have to do type declarations. What we mean by that is type declaration basically meant, what we mean by type declaration is basically when you define the type of the variable, integer or those kind of things. Now, automatic memory management. I'll explain this, but I'll explain you what exactly is memory management kind of a thing. When I was discussing about C++, we need to deal with pointers, as in we need to deal with the memory addresses where the variable is pointing to. Once your variable is gone, you need to dereference a pointer as well. That's very important, or that is called as a memory leakage kind of a thing. So memory management is a mix of, it's a general term you can say for the memory leak issue, or something like where you want to dereference whichever memory you're pointing to. So that's what Python deals with it automatically. Once the scope is gone, obviously it will just remove those variables and throw it away. Object oriented. This I told you in the beginning, it's a complete, fully fledged object oriented language. Garbage collection is something, you know, once you, the scope of the variable is gone. Scope as in, you know, when you're using a variable, yes, it stays in the memory. There is a place associated or assigned for that variable into the memory. Once that is goes out of the scope, you're into some other function or something, that memory would have been gone. So that's what I mean by that. Wide portability, like I was telling you the example of, okay, memory leak. Okay, Binish, I'll come to that. Just a moment. Wide portability. So wide portability as in, like I was giving the example of Linux to Windows kind of a system. You're writing something in Linux, you bring it to Windows, run it, it will run as good as whatever, you know, however your code was running. Easy integration, yeah, that's of course there with it. Now some of the uses of Python that we have. Okay, before going to that, I'll address Binish's question of what is memory leak. Okay, let me take an example on giving you a better understanding. Okay, let's assume you have a, no, I'm going a bit hardcore technical into this now with respect to the how it happens with the RAM memory, how your variables are defined, or all those things. I'll try to simplify as much as possible, but there are few places which I might not be. Please, you know, let me know, Binish and anyone else for that matter. That's a good question that you asked. So let's say you want to, you have a system machine has a 4 GB of RAM, for example, and you have a file that you want to read and do some processing on top of it. Now what you do is you read that file. That file has, for example, is of 2.5 GB, for example. Okay. Now you have a 2.5 GB file which you want to read in your 4 GB RAM memory, because whenever you read, it will basically, you know, store it in the RAM memory. That's a temporary storage. And then whenever that is out of the scope, it will clear that cache off or whatever you want to call it. Now this memory leak will happen. For example, let's say you read that file and you read the content of the file into one variable. That variable will have definitely some, would have occupied some space more than 2.5 GB. I say more because there would be some of the metadata that would have been that would have come into picture on what is the length of the file, and not necessarily length, but some of the metadata that is definitely there. So what happens is, let's say you created it into variable A, for example. You did some, you assigned some other variables with, you started doing some chunks of that data and started keeping that into some other variables as you moved on. But it did not clear off the space that was there in the original variables. At one point, you will hit a place where your heap memory is exhausted. Once your heap memory is exhausted, it will give you a memory error. It cannot store more variables into the RAM memory or the heap memory that you have. It cannot store more variables. And once it cannot store, it will basically throw an error. That's your one of the scenario of memory leak. And since you know you have some background C++, I'll give you one more example. Have you come across the memory functions called malloc or calloc or realloc? If you have not, I'll give you a brief for everyone actually. These functions, just you know, maybe after the not really or no problem. Just after the session, if you just read about that, you'll come to know malloc and these kind of variables provides you the capability. So C++ provides you the capability by these functions on allocating the memory at the runtime. What that means is you wanted to read a list which will be only of it will have only two elements, but you have already defined a list of size 10, for example, you know, for the sake of argument. If you have a list defined for size 10 and you're reading only two variables into it, what will happen is your memory is occupied for 10 integers, but you are putting only two. What about the rest 8? The compiler or your SYST machine is not smart enough, or rather it's not about being smart. It does not have the permission to release of the memory of those 8 variables. It cannot do that because you have assigned something to it. What could be a better solution here? A better solution could be whenever you get one variable, create a memory for one variable only using a function like malloc, M-A-L-L-O-C. That's how it's spelled. So using a malloc function, you create a space for the variable into the memory. Now you have only one variable and you created the space for one variable. Now the next time you got the second variable. Now you create a space for second and yeah, it is linked. Now both of them are in a list. The space used is only for two variables. And in our example, we had only two. We had created the space for 10, but we're using only two. In this case, what happened is we are using the memory only for two. Now what will happen is, for example, if you have allocated the memory using malloc or these kind of functions, the memory will not be destroyed until you manually using the code if you do not release that memory. I am, you know, forgetting the name of that function. I'm not sure if it is realloc or calloc. I'm just, you know, having a little bit hard time remembering the function name. But that function will basically delete the memory that was assigned initially using malloc. If you do not do that, just imagine you kept on using those variables. Now, even after you don't have any need for those variables, they are still lying in your heap memory. What is the use? There's no use, right? You need to release that memory. That's what is memory leak. You have used the memory, your variables are no more needed, but they are still lying in your memory, useless there. That's what is meant by memory leak. Does that answer your question, Vinish? Memory leak is linked to a potential overflow. Okay, Alex, I'll come to that. Last sentence. Okay, what did I say? I told you about when you allocate a memory into the heap space, if you do not release the memory, it will keep on, you know, accumulating on that, and then you will have a situation where you do not have anything more to assign. So that's what will happen in case of memory leak. If you keep on, memory will get leaked because the variables are not used, but the memory is still lying for them. So that's what it means. So Alex is asking basically, I hope my screen is visible to anyone anyways, so still, but I'll repeat. So it is a case of a potential overflow. Yes, once you have, it is a case of potential overflow as in when the user is not taking care of these things. These kind of scenarios generally come in language like C++, where we have the capability, we assign the using malloc and these functions, we assign the memory on our own. When we assign the memory, you don't release that memory once you are done, you will end up in a case of overflow. Like you had 4 GB of RAM, You kept on assigning variables, 4 GB. There are some processes that are still running in your system as well. It's just not your code that is running. You know, you will have, let's say, only 3 GB of RAM available. You kept on using them. At the end, you are out of the memory, right? That's more or less what is memory leak. So yes, it is linked to a potential overflow that can happen. Alex, does that answer your question? And Binish, in simple. Binish, no, that's not the case. So I'll tell you the difference also now, since you bring this up. Like you're taking the example of having pictures in your mobile and you don't delete it. No, that's not the case. RAM memory is volatile. It is there only till the time you're executing your code or your system is running. The memory in your phone, the example you're telling that you're taking, is more of a hard disk. That memory will persist how much ever it is. That is not a case of memory leak. There you can't avoid a memory leak. That is a physical storage. That is physical storage in your machine, the hard disk, where the tape has the data on it, where you can read it. It will never be destroyed unless you go and delete it. That's not the case. This is different. So the mobile, the pictures in your mobile is like more of a storage, the hard disk storage that you have. The memory leak is the case with the RAM memory. Whenever you restart your system, your RAM memory gets refreshed. So that it is fresh, you can allocate how many variables you want. So those two are not the same cases. It is more like, I'll tell you, in your mobile, I'm sure if you use an iOS-based mobile, an iPhone, or let's say an Android-based system, I hope you would have seen a button where you see all the recent apps and you clear them off, right? Now, let me take that example. When you have the apps running your system, every app has some variables allocated in your RAM of your phone. Whenever you destroy that app, that memory gets released from the app. Sorry, gets released from the RAM. Now what happens is, this is the memory that we're talking about, memory leak. You keep on putting more and more usage into RAM, you don't release anything. At one point, you might have observed, I guess, your phone, you know, tend to become a little slower from time to time. You just restart your phone, it becomes fresh again, right? That's more analogous to a memory leak than the example that you have taken. Let's see, right? Okay, thank you, Vinish. Yeah, any other questions at this point? This is a very, you know, highly technical concept, this memory leak kind of a thing. You don't see that very often, but since, you know, we had the topic, I thought it's you know, I always follow this. Sharing some knowledge will never harm you. Knowing something extra, there's no problem. Let it be. If it's useful, we'll see. If it is not, let's keep it back in your head. No problem with that. So any questions about that as of now? About that or anything else still what we have covered till now? Okay, I guess we are good. Let's move on. So let's go with the uses of Python. Some basic uses: you can create some shell tools, UI, and you can design your website for that. You can do application development, game development, data science, of course, is the one that we are going to focus on. But there are multiple uses for Python. So, you know, in end of the session, which I'm sure you will not feel this, but if you feel that data science is something which is not relevant to you, Python, you always have the knowledge of Python. You can do n number of things with it. But I'm sure that will never happen. This is such a field that when, you know, this becomes even more interesting when you hear the use cases that can be built on using Python, or not Python, sorry, data science or machine learning algorithms that you can build, the use cases, the application that you can build, it becomes even more interesting. And at the same time, challenging for you. Yes, if this is possible, let's try one more version of it, how we can build that. That's how, you know, you get more and more interest. You know, an application as simple as, not as simple, I'm sorry. I was about to take the example of Siri, actually. So sorry to Apple that I said that as an easy example. By no means that's easy. But something very handy, I should say, which you use, like Siri, is basically machine learning, right? We'll discuss about these things in detail later, but for now, you know, most of the things that you see are some or the other way, if not machine learning, some kind of analytics and some of kind of patterns that are seen in the data and applications built on top of it based on that. Now there are some, this particular slide is, you know, honestly, my personal recommendation on my experience. By no means this means that you know, that I'm restricting or refraining from you to use Python, but this is based on my experience, what I have used. Not as efficient as C. It's efficient. We write our code in a smarter way. We can make it even more efficient, but still C, C++ will beat Python any day with respect to efficiency only. And there is some lack of profiling tools. You know, this I have also experienced on my own experience. The profiling tools, as in the tools that we see on how much memory your variables are using. So, and which part of your code is taking more time? Meaning when you have a, let's say you have a piece of code, let's say you have 100 lines, whatever the 100 lines contains, trivial, doesn't matter. Let's see, you have 100 lines of code. There is one particular part of code which is taking, when you're running the entire code, you'll not come to know which part of the code is taking more time. Let's say it was taking 2 seconds to execute. For a simple program, 2 seconds is like unacceptable. It is taking 2 seconds to run, but you do not know which part of the code is taking that much time. You use profiling tools to come to know which part or the modules of code are taking more time, so that if there are operations like reading a file, for example, is taking the most time, there sometimes you are bound that, you know, you really can't do anything. The data is too huge. You have to take that much time. There is no other go. You can do after you get the data into variable, parse it, or, you know, fetch the relevant information out of it quickly so that you deal with smaller, you deal with variables which are smaller in size now and all those things. So that can be done. But if the reading of the file takes so much time, you really can't help it. But profiling tools helps you in understanding which part of your code is taking more time. So that's what, and also in the memory as well. In the case of memory as well, it tells you which variable has the more memory allocated in the heap at a particular time. And if you want to clear that memory, is it possible to clear that or not? So that's few of the things that profiling tools help you. I have used a couple of tools, but, you know, I was not so impressed by them. So while, you know, you do your research, and if you come across some wonderful tools, please recommend me as well. I'll also look into it. Yeah, that's what is about Python. Now, let's see a few things about Python 2 versus Python 3. There are, you might have heard, or if you're not woke, you might not have heard in that case. You know, there are, in general, 2.x, everything is considered as Python 2. Any version 3.x is considered as Python 3. It's not there, but, and there have been significant changes into Python 2 and 3. There are a few parts of the code where it is possible to port your code from one version to another. But in some cases, it's not possible also. Sometimes you'll have to, you know, you will have to sit and do your code changes into your code so that it runs in both the environment. So that is one thing that you will have to face from time to time. But if you are stuck to one of the versions, let's say from end to end writing Python 2, you don't have to worry about those things. And there are options available, like some modules, for example, I'll take, there's a module called Future. You know, while writing the code in Python 2, you can use that module and use the functions that are introduced only in Python 3, in Python 2 also. So there are provisions for doing that. But if you're going to do that, you might as well write your entire code in Python 3, you know, but it depends on the situation. So yeah, that's one other thing about Python 2 and 3. We'll see a couple of basic differences that have come. Not basic as in the most looked upon or something which has, you know, has a wide impact. One of them is print function. So when I use a print function, it basically, if I just show you here, if I write print A, this is how it prints. In Python 3, you'll have to write it like this. In some parts, print will still work like this. Actually, it does work, but in general, Python for you, you will have to do it in a way where print has become a function now rather than a command is not the right word, but I'm not sure what would be the right word. Like you give a print A kind of a thing, you'll have to use the brackets there so that you can define your variables and you can print those functions. So that's one of the indicator. Now, the other thing is about the division. So whenever we do a division in Python, this is one of the, I would say, honestly speaking, one of the irritating things that I find about Python 2, which has been fixed in Python 3 now. Whenever you do a division, let's say 1 by 2, that ideally we'll assume that it's 0.5, right? That's not the case. It'll give you one. Oh no, not one, in fact zero. It always does the rounding of the integer there. Rounding of the float value that whichever you get. For example, it gives you zero. But what if you want 0.5? How do you do that? In that case, let's say you do this. You get 0.5. What this means is, if all the variables were of integer type, 1 and 2, it will give you an integer result. If even one of the variable is of float or a decimal kind of a type, it will give you the decimal value. So that's how you get this. These things, you know, while we're doing the coding, you will, once you face into, you know, I honestly believe in that. One, these kind of features you learn once you get stuck in those kind of issues. Unless otherwise, this will never be on your head that, yeah, this is how Python 2 works, that 1 by 2 will be 0. So once you are stuck into those issues once or twice, then it will remain in your head forever that, yeah, this is how Python 2 works. Okay. Any doubts at this moment or any questions? I'm expecting more questions from more people. You know, my chat is full of like 2-3 people only. So I would prefer more people, you know, coming up. Now, that by no means, I mean that you have to ask simply. As long as you're understanding, that's fine. But the point being, you don't restrict yourself from asking anything. Okay. Yeah. So. So Hector asks, the integer division is for version 2 that is rounded or for version 3 also? Understood. So the integer division, if you do 1 by 2 in Python 3, it will by default give you 0.5. If you give 1 divided by 2.0, it will still give you 0.5. That this still remains as is. This has got no change at all. If there is any of the float variable in the division, it will give you a float value. But this statement in Python 3 will give 0.5, whereas it is giving me 0 as of now. Does that answer your question, Hector? Okay, thank you. Yeah, that's one other thing. Now, exception handling, I'll actually prefer covering, I've just put it, you know, just mark it as a note that, yeah, there are some changes with respect to exception handling, but we'll deal with these things, you know, in the later stage when we know what is exception handling. Because even if I tell you now, it will be a little difficult to understand that. Okay. So once we're dealing with that, we'll discuss about how the exception handling things work and how it is varying from Python 2 to 3. And again, this is actually quite interesting, this global namespace leak. So we'll discuss about these things as well. What a namespace is, first of all. What is a global namespace? How that works. When we are discussing about the actual implementation in coding, we'll see what that means. Then one of the method is basically input. This has changed now. So the input method is basically about taking a user input. So the difference what has come now is, in Python 2, this input method is whatever you input for this. Once you use the input method, it will give you a prompt, as in expecting the user to type something from the standard input. Whatever you type will get converted to an integer in Python 2. But not necessarily it needs to be integer all the time. So for having a string variable, we used to have a function raw input, that is raw_input. We used to have that function which will always convert to directly string only. That's a raw string as you get from the user. Then we can convert into different data types wherever you want to. That was possible. But input method did not have that facility. In Python 3, input method has basically become the raw input, in simple words. Now input will accept anything whatever you enter to him, and it is there to accept whatever data points you have, right? Yeah. Banker's rounding. Okay, that's I would say something actually. I found myself, because it's not, you know, very highly useful, but still, since I found it interesting, so I put it up, but it's not something which will impact your work or the coding from Python 2 to 3. So basically in Python 2, what would happen is any decimal value in between, like 0.5 or in between, whenever you have, it will be rounded off to the lowest integer. So 16.5 becomes 16 kind of a thing. whenever we're rounding off. But in case of Python 3, it will round off to the nearest even integer. So that's the only difference there. It's not very important, but you know, you might as well skip this point. If you do that, that's also fine. But still, since this was there, so I just put it up here. So the difference is only it will round off to the nearest even integer. When you're working on it, you'll come to know better, but it's not very important that as a very huge change that has happened. There are many other actually. I've skipped actually a lot of them because if you start discussing a difference, it'll take you a lot of time. And these are some of the basic ones that you generally see. And which should solve your basic issues, whichever you feel in Python 2 to 3. By seeing the code, you should be able to understand what kind of code that is and all that. Yeah, so are there any questions at this point? Okay. Yeah. Now we'll move to installation. We'll be installing the software called Anaconda, which I told you earlier as well. Now, first of all, why do we use this? First, it's a complete package. So this software will install your Python as well. And there's no licensing issue with this software, no problem at all. So anyone can, it's there out in the open. Just download it, install, there's no issues at all. It will install your Python first of all. Then it will preset up the environment accordingly for you. And after that, it will install all the necessary or at least basic libraries that you use in terms of machine learning. Libraries like Pandas, SkyKit, sklearn, all the random forest algorithm for that matter. It will install all your basic libraries there. So once you have done this, you don't have to worry about all the IPython installation or one by one, you don't have to install your libraries. You just get rid of all those things. That's why I always advise everyone to do this. And it's quite famous as well. You know, a lot of people are using this these days. Most widely used software for data science, actually, that is. So it's used quite heavily. Now, I will be sharing the content anyways later, so it's not that you have to make a note of all these links. It's actually as good as, you just Google about the Anaconda installation, you will have it. So shouldn't be a problem. But still, I just put it up. So I'm assuming everyone, it's not right to assume, but yeah. Is there anyone who is using Mac system? For Windows, if you just go to the link, you will have the binary there. Just download it and execute the next steps in the final finish thing and you'll be done with it. It's quite simple. And then for Linux, all you need to do is do a wget. Wget is basically a utility for Linux system that tells you get those libraries of files from the website to your local system. That's one other thing. Once you get this file, you just have to do a bash this or sh this, anything will work. It'll ask you for the couple of approvals, yes, no, do you want to do this and all those things that I'm sure you can take care of. That's a very small thing which I would not prefer spending so much of time on. Then, yeah, there are a couple of Mac users. No, that's perfectly fine, not a problem. Chandana says he is using Jupyter Notebook. So is that something that you've installed separately or you have installed using Anaconda, the Jupyter Notebook, or how is it? In the meanwhile, for the users of Mac, you don't have to worry. You go to this link, you install a .pkg file, .package file, and you can go ahead with the installation, that will work. Or you can hit this command, which will basically give you the sh file and again do a bash of that file, that will also work for you, as simple as that. I generally prefer doing this rather than, at least in Mac, in my own system, I have a Mac system, so I prefer doing a curl of that file and doing a bash installation. That works, works like a charm actually. You shouldn't face any problem with that. Once I give you the link, you just copy these links and use it. Just use these commands directly. That's good enough. And for Linux and Mac OS user, what you might have to do for the first instance is restart your terminal, just the terminal window that you're using. If you don't want to restart, just source your bash file. So you have a bash rc file in there. there is a bash ASCII file which actually keeps the path of a Python and all those things. You will have to source it again. Source, meaning of sourcing is, now that's something which you know comes in when you know about Linux. When you start a terminal for Linux, be it Mac or be it Linux, whenever you start a Linux terminal, there is the file bash RC and dot profile and all those files which will get executed, and the commands which are lying in there. So I'll give you an example actually. Okay, this is something what I have done. Okay, those files, what that would need is it should be dot profile, I guess. This is one file actually. I'm forgetting the name. This is one of it, which you need to source it whenever a Linux terminal started. If you don't, because that path, whatever Anaconda path is there, would be set up into that file. If you restart your terminal, it will be as good as, you don't have to worry about sourcing. So that's a much easier way of doing it. And yeah, that shouldn't be a problem, it's quite straightforward. And with respect to, okay, Chandana, you have installed separately, that's also fine. Should not be a problem. If you do a installation of Anaconda as well, that's okay. It will install the entire package for you. And all the libraries, whatever needed, that should not be a problem. You can use that as well. So yeah. So any other questions as of now with respect to installation? I'm not giving you the exact steps because I don't believe in spoon feeding anything. This is the start to learn exploring different packages, because this is just one package. When you get into machine learning, you will see a hell lot of open source code that you'll be having, and you will have to use those codes from time to time. So you need to get used to installing these libraries, that library, and all those things. So you'll be doing it directly. And yes, Alex, you'll be doing 2.7. And yeah, for these, yeah, if you directly for Linux and Mac, if you directly go to these links, this will give you the 2.7 Linux. For Windows, if you go to this link, you will have two options for 2.7 and 3.6. Just go with 2.7. Okay. Yeah. Any other thing with respect to installation? So this would be basically your assignment for today. So you need to get everything done and see that everything is up and running. Yeah, looks okay then. Okay. So the next thing, just a couple of pointers, which is, you know, not something very widely used, but still if it is there. So there is a path variable in Unix that basically has the path of all your executables and all those things. So if you see like the dollar path, if you are much familiar with Linux, you'll understand it better. These are the environment variables that are there, which points to the Python path, or it'll then again, when you do this export path equal to dollar path, and this will basically append the path, whichever is this user local bin Python, into whatever the path variable already has. So this is basically append it. So this is what that basically for path doing for that. And then you have, for Windows, you have this path variable. I am not very much into, you know, I have never used this variable much. So there's no problem with that also anyways. But if you install Anaconda, these path and all you don't have to worry about, it will directly be, you know, set up into your environment, and that will be good to go. So Astra, you're using Spyder 3.5, that should not be a problem. But sometimes I have seen that if you already have 3.5 version, it's advisable to remove that and then install the Python, then another version. In our case, it will be 2.7, to install it again and remove the previous versions. It's usually advisable. But even if you install the 2.7 Python, or if you want, you can continue with Spyder 3.5 also. That will not create much of a difference. It's just that in my slide, whenever you're seeing some of the codes here and there, there will be minute difference, because I use a mix of, sometimes I majorly focus on 2.7 only, but sometimes you will have, there will be some commands which are from 3.5, generally varying. You can see the code and understand, but if you're using Spyder 3.5, that also should be okay. And in that case, maybe you can might want to install the Jupyter notebook also separately. And you know, just because of these hassles, the spider installation separately, Python install separately, notebook install separately, then the libraries of data science. That's why I advise Anaconda. It will give you everything at once. So if you want, you can just reinstall the Python 3.0, the spider 3.5, and install a fresh Anaconda, and it will take care of everything, right? Does that answer your question, Astro? Okay, I'm assuming your silence to be yes. Just ping me if you have any other thing. I'll move on till then. Now for running the Python, yes, the interactive interpreter, which I showed you in my terminal. The other thing is basically from the command line, you can basically type Python space whatever file you have, and that will take care of I don't know why people are sending the private message, because my screen is anyways visible, but that's okay. You can type it to everyone. That should be okay. So yeah, anyways, so you can type, you know, Python and give the Python file. It will execute using the command line as well. And then you have the IDEs, basically the development environment, like, you know, the one which, you know, Astra and someone else was mentioning about the Jupyter notebook as well. Yeah, Chandana. So these are different things basically that are basically your IDs, how you want to do it using the Python. That's all it is. Oh, is it okay? Sorry, you might not have it. I have some drop down here which tells me whom I want to send the message to. But anyways, no worries. I was just, you know, trying to lighten up the moment. Okay, anyways. Yeah. So next is basically as simple as how to use an interactive interpreter. Now we'll start with a basic Hello World program. So now, like I did the last time at the terminal, all you need to do is basically, if you type Python, yes, you have it. You are into the shell now. Now, let's say you want to print a Hello World. So your Hello World program for Python is as simple as this one line. I'm sorry for the typo. It's as simple as that. Now you can do the same thing by writing in the file. I'll just show you a couple of ways so that you know what is meant by interpretive, what is meant by when you said about the writing it from command line. And then for the IDE also, I'll show you a snapshot on how it looks like. Once you have the installation ready tomorrow, today, then we'll start with that also tomorrow. So yes, this is just your first Python program. You have written it. Thank you and congratulations. It's as simple as that. Now the thing is, the interpreter is good for small calculations. You know, you want to do some basic thing. I personally use the interpreter heavily, you know, for some basic commands to test how it will work for sample codes. But it's up to your wish. You want to do that or not. These days, the Jupyter notebook and those things have become quite handy. It becomes easier there. One advice that I will give you is, start doing, if you want to do some basic calculation kind of a thing, rather than opening a calculator, open a Python terminal, start doing something. What this will do is basically get you used to on how you write some basic things in Python, and it will make you used to the interpretive shell also. So that's the only idea there, nothing else, not mandatory, but just, you know, get to give you a feel of it. So that's what we have. Now for the scripting types, let's say you create a file here. Let me do that here. Let's say I write my Hello World program. I write my one statement like I wrote the last time. So while for executing it, all I have to do is Python first program or first program, whatever name I have kept here. Yes, it prints your Hello World, whatever was printed there, right? So there are different ways. You go to the shell and do it, you go to write into a file and do it, it's up to you. Okay. Yeah, so that's how you use it. Now the third way is about Jupyter notebook. So a couple of people, like you told me, already have used this, so this would look familiar. But for people who have not used it, this is how it will look like. Once you're done with the installation, you will start using it, it will be quite simple. So you write your print here, and this is more of an interactive thing as well. It'll print your output here and you can go on and creating multiple cells and writing a small pieces of code there, right? So this Jupyter Notebook, honestly, I'm a very huge fan of it. It's quite handy when you have to visualize the data here and you have to do some basic slicing and dicing of the data and see how much data you have and all those basic kind of things, and making a smaller, like a baseline model, first of all, and seeing how it looks like, what's the accuracy there. It becomes quite handy. Once you want to put your core into production and something, Jupyter Notebook is something that you would not use there. You will use most of the time a shell kind of a thing like we have here, and you'll write into, you'll compile, you'll, you know, collate all your code into one file or multiple files on how much model you want to keep, depends on you and those things. And then you will see on how, you know, we can go about it. So that's another way. Now, just one thing is about the platform independence. Like, yes, Python is platform independent. It can be used across platform. So a similar code, it can run on Unix, Windows, and macOS, as long as the required package is installed, obviously. You know, if you're using some external package of Python, then that has to be installed. That's not something that the platform will do for you. You have to do it yourself. So this is some basic idea about on Python. So any questions at this moment? Okay. Yeah, for Python, even a simple Notepad is an editor. And in fact, in Notepad++ these days is quite handy. You know, you can do a lot of things with that. So Vim editor is, if you see this, what I did here, this VI thing is basically a Vim editor, VI editor, you want to call it. Then Jupyter Notebook, Spider, Sublime Text, and any kind of a text editors can be converted into a Python editor. You just save the file in the .py extension and run it. That should be good enough, right? And in fact, you can use familiar with the Eclipse, if you have done some coding. And I think there are plugins available for Python, although I have not used it, but I'm not really sure on that. But I think there are plugins that are available there. Now, this slide, just forget about what this code is doing. This is just to give you an idea on how a typical Python code looks like. Couple of ideas. First thing, if you notice, there are no semicolons at the end of the line. Second thing, if you notice the indentation. For example, forget about what is the functionality of this code. You don't have to worry, but just see how it looks like. First line, you'll take the input of file name. You have defined a variable, and then you do a with open. Basically, you're opening a file. Then the next two lines are the for line in F and the num lines plus equal to one. Basically, you're just counting the number of lines in there. So all the next two lines are indented so that these are a part of this first with open block. What this means is the for line in F is a part of with open file, right? And if you want to make a block of code inside for, we went on another indent level. So if you see in the first three lines, F name equal to input and num line, all three are in the same indentation. That means those are continuous lines. These are also, other ones also continuous, but they are not a separate block. It's going one by one in sequence. But in this case, when you indent it, the next line would be a part of this particular with open block. Now the num lines plus equal to one is again one more level indented. So that is a part of this for line in F block. That's how it will go. So whenever there is a for loop, if it is doing num line plus equal to one, it will keep on executing this num line plus equal to one multiple times until there are lines there. Forget about how the for loop works and all those things, but just to give you an idea. Then we have a couple of print statements which are again back to normal indent. That means they're again back to the normal basic sequence which are there, right? So this is how a typical code looks like. Yeah, any questions on that? Till then, any specific versions of Notepad? There's a long time back when I used the, I've left the Windows system and moved on to Mac, but I would advise you to download Notepad++. That's quite handy with respect to be it Python or an SQL query or a shell scripting also, that comes in very handy. So that has some of the inbuilt, you know, the editors or the plugins that helps you a lot while coding. Easier to search for something and easier to read as well. So a Notepad++, whatever latest version is available, should be okay for you. For Windows, if you are on. Okay. Yeah. Any questions on the basic syntax or anything till now that we have been talking about? Okay. I'll move on then. Now again, yeah, this is what was I was telling you about indentation. So if any block of code, it will basically come inside after a tab spaced so that you know where you are lying, right? So that's what you'll have. Then just, you know, so I'll basically be closing my session after these comments part and something, just a couple of more slides. But this is just the starting of what we'll be looking into the next from the next session. That is going to be proper into the coding. This first session, I hope I tried my best, you know, just to keep it more interactive and, you know, giving some of the use cases that I worked on so that you have good idea. So these couple of slides more for today, basically. This is just the start, how we go into the programming. From next session, you'll have the entire functions, what you use and the programming that you're doing with respect to programming assignments. Also, you'll have some of the assignment for you so you can have a look. So let me finish up this, then, you know, I'll talk about a couple of more things later. So comments is basically something that we put into our code for the better understanding this. So comments is like just the lines of code which do not get executed by the compiler. So there are ways to how you define that particular line so that it is judged as a comment by your compiler or your interpreter. So he will not execute that particular line. He will just keep it like it is a string. Just skip it and move on. So usually it is advisable. Although I've written all code must contain, but even if you don't put any comments, it's not going to be create any effect on the compiler. It's just that, you know, and I'm speaking this on my experience. You write a code, you write some complex logic, you visit that code like a two weeks or a month later, you'll not be able to understand what you have written. Seriously. You can think, okay, I have written this logic, I'll understand it later. No, it doesn't happen. You face a lot of struggle and you waste a lot of time in just understanding what basically you had written and what you had thought at that time. So usually comments help you in that way. And if someone else is reading your code, you know, it helps the person as well on where to start and what that particular logic is doing. That helps you. So in Python, we have, you know, any line that is beginning with a hash sign are comment lines. So that's basically, this entire line is a comment, like it is starting with the hash. So you can have a comment after the statement as well. Whenever it sees a hash, so x equal to 5 and set up a loop counter, both of the things are the same line. That also is allowed. So that's how you define your comments into the Python. It's advised that you always keep comments there so that you understand the code well, where how you want to deal with it, and for other people also, you know, it becomes easily understandable. And yeah, that's about the comments of the code, and that brings me to the end of today's session. So now I'd open up, you know, it's open for any questions or queries that you have, anything that you dealt with today. Oh yes. Okay. Yeah, Hector. Correct. I'll come to that. If there are no questions, then I'll come to that. Okay. Thank you, Vinish. If it is, you know, I hope today I can understand if someone has a complaint that we didn't do any programming. Yes, but I really can't help it. I need to get you to the core basics first. And, you know, so that you understand what we are doing, how the interpreter thing works, how the compiler thing works and all those things. You need to understand that. So then when you go to the coding, then you'll have a better picture there. If you're, you know, it's like a building. If your first floor is not good enough or your ground floor is not good enough, you can't create a tall building. So we need to make our ground or the foundations good. So that's the whole point. I'm assuming there are no questions as of now. Okay, thank you, Astra. If a comment is in several lines, you have to put a hash on each line. You have to put hash, and there are some kind of multi-line comments as well. And I think that will be a part of Okay, yeah, that is there. I have that part as well. How we put multi-line comment, basically use a triple quote if you put. So triple quote is the starting of the block of a comment, multiple lines. And when you want to edit, you again put a triple quote. We have that part also later. So no worries. So there are ways of, you know, defining it from end to end. Yeah. So I'll explain you about one of the use case that I was telling you. Thank you, Hector, for reminding me. I almost forgot. So, okay. So you see, it's actually not related to, it's related to a natural language processing, but not something very similar to what we did in the case of, I explained in the case of Trump. So there is actually a paper published on that as well. I'll give you the references of those papers once we are into the proper machine learning and we have got into the mathematics. Because if we give you that upfront, that will, you know, I don't want to scare you out of these things and, you know, get an impression that it's something difficult. So what we did was, basically for, I'll prefer not taking any names here. So basically for any retail chain, I'll take an example there. So, and in the meanwhile, while I'm you know, discussing about this, if you have any doubt, just keep it, just you know, send a message. I'll take up those questions later, be it with respect to today's session or with respect to the example that I'm taking. So the idea was basically in a retail company. So I'm sure you people go to Tesco in London and you know, you see a lot of products there. The thing is, if I tell you that you have a black jeans and you have a refrigerator and you have a black shirt. Let's say there are three products. Now, given an example like this, like you have three products, there are any number of, but let's take only these three. By knowing, you know that, yeah, black shirt and black jeans are somewhat similar. Refrigerator is like, you know, like in an altogether different world in this case. But you do not have a way. Now, how do you write a code that will tell you that, yes, black jeans and black shirt are similar, but black jeans is far apart from refrigerator? Because you can't do that. In normal programming, you can't do that. At least I am not sure how you do that. Even if you come up with an idea, okay, very well presented, it will be very complex, taking all the words from here and there and all those things will come into picture. But what if I give you a scenario that I'm representing black jeans as a number 5, just one single number 5. For example, how I come up with that number is the whole logic. But let's assume I come up with a number 5 and I know that black shirt is quite nearby to it. So that will be somewhere around, let's say 6 or 7 for that matter. And refrigerator easily would be somewhere in the range of, let's say 50, 60, or I mean, far apart is what I'm trying to say, right? Now, if I give you these numbers, you don't have to see even what the product description was. You don't have to see whether it was black jeans or a black shirt. All you see is if 5 and 6 are there, yeah, that is close by. If you see 50, yeah, that's quite far apart. That's something different. I don't know what that is, but that's something different, right? You get this idea now. Now, what can be done is, what natural language processing, in fact, this was there are open libraries from Microsoft as well in the NLTK, and there are many libraries for these. What they are capable of doing is, when you see these kind of descriptions of products like black jeans and black shirt, they have the capability of creating a vector for every product. What I mean by a vector is it's like a list of 100 numbers. Meaning, let's say we had 5 products, for example, and each of those 5 products will be represented by a vector of 100 numbers. A vector is like a list of numbers, you can assume. Nothing else, nothing other than that. As simple as it gets, as a list of 100 numbers for each product. Now, 5 products have each 100 dimensional vector for each product. Now, when I took an example of the number 5, 6, and 50, now assume instead of 5, 6, and 50, you have a vector for each other product. Now, what that means is, in mathematics, I'm sure you would have learned about calculating distance between two vectors, be it an Euclidean distance or any sort of distance. You can calculate the distance. Now, once you have the distances between the multiple products, you can calculate the distance and come to know that which products are similar to you, similar to the product X, if it is Y similar to it, if X is not similar to Y? Is it something different? That's one of the use cases that come to picture. Now, what those 100 dimensions represent is, you know, that is one of the, now these 100 dimension in machine learning world, we call it embeddings. Now, this concept has actually come from natural language. When you have a word or a sentence, you can create an embedding for it. That's called a word embedding. Now, when we have a word embedding, we can have a product embedding also. You have a product in Tesco, I can create a numerical representation of this product. When you have a numerical representation, let's, in our example, let's say we have a 100 dimensional vector. All the vectors that are there, all the 100 dimensional vector for various products that are there are comparable to each other numerically now. Earlier, you can't compare a black shirt and black jeans together. But now you have a number for each of them. You create, calculate the distances. You can do a lot of things with it. You have those things. You can compare them numerically. Once you compare them numerically, you know which are far apart, which are similar to each other. Now, what is the use case for this? A very simple and basic use case, recommend the products. If a person is looking at a product, black jeans, take the five nearest product, take the five nearest products who have a similar embedding to black jeans. You just publish it in the Amazon app. I'm sure you would have used the Amazon app. You see those products there, right? Down, people who bought this also bought this. Yep. Yes, you can. In the theoretical way, as of now, you have implemented that. How we implement this, that's altogether a different thing. Don't worry about that. But just to give you an idea where this can be used, this is one of the things you can use. Next, for example, you went to Tesco, you bought a product X, but now my code is there. Now I have a code which tells me that if a person has bought this, he is bound to buy this. He could have bought this, or he could have been recommended some other product. You just send it over an email. You do those things, right? And yeah, right. That's Binish. That is what is market basket analysis. But market basket analysis is not just about the description of product. This is, I am not considering any purchase pattern of the person. Market basket analysis comes into picture when I'm analyzing what products have been bought together. Let's say there are product A, B, and C. Let's say Binish went to Tesco and bought A, B, and C. And Hector went and he bought only B and C. Now my code is, that's a different thing. That has nothing to do with natural language now. Now I know Hector has bought B and C. How can I make him buy? What could be a product that he might buy next, or he might be in need of? You recommend him product A because A, B, C have generally been bought together by a lot of people. But Hector only bought B and C. I'll recommend him A as well. That's what is market basket analysis. This is similar, but we are not considering any purchase pattern into this. With the embeddings, yes, what we get is that what is the numerical representation? You can compare the products against each other now. When you have only the description, it is harder for you to compare. Once you have the embeddings or the vectors for every product, you create a system where you can compare different products. And now then you can, you know, once you have that, then you can create n number of use cases. One of them, you have the product embeddings. What you do with product embeddings, you take the average of all the products bought by a customer. What you get? You get customer embedding. This is the kind of product that this person buys. Now you can compare customer to customer. Then you can have market basket analysis. Then you can have a lookalike models and n number of things that, you know, it's like an endless thing that you can push in based on the requirement, or you can create, you can propose these kind of things. Asra, that's right. Recommender system is an application for this, right? So that's one of the example which I wanted to take with respect to natural language, how you have just a product name, multiple product name, how you create a recommendation system just by product names only. In this case, I am not able to complement your product, but I am in a situation where I can supplement it. If you're buying a black jeans, something similar to black jeans, there are like blue jeans or this jeans or that jeans. Yes, there could be supplement for your products. But just with product description, I can complement it. Once I do the purchase pattern and I do a proper market basket analysis, then yes, then I can bring in the entire recommender system, entire recommender system, wherein I can tell you that this product can be, you can bought in this instead of this or something of those sort, right? Okay. So I hope that was interesting. So any questions on this? what I explained today in the session or this use case that I explained. I've stopped my screen share just in case you're wondering if you're not able to see. So I'll wait for a minute. I'll give you 1 minute, one more minute, maybe just to see if you have anything else. Okay, so if you have any sort of feedback based on the first session, you know, if you have some pointers on how we can make it even more interesting, you know, I'm all ears. Let me know in the chat here or just drop you an email. Sharon is here. Yeah, I'm not sure via Sharon or directly to me. So, okay. Okay, thank you guys. So let's catch up tomorrow then.
Hey, Naveen, I'm here.
Yeah, so anything else that you need to take care of?
For now, I think I would need you to share the training material for this session, and I'll ask the technical team to share the link for the today's recorded session to all the participants.
Sure. Okay.
So I request everyone to share your Gmail ID. Some of you have not shared your Gmail IDs because the recorded video sessions would be on Google Drive, and you'd be able to open only through. So please share your Gmail IDs.
Sharon, do I need to take a note on how many people have attended, or you have taken care of that?
Yes, I have taken care of that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, and I think Alex has shared his Gmail ID. Hector and Tom, Thomas. Can you share your Gmail ID, please? Thank you, Hector. Rory, Rory Burn, can you share your Gmail ID, please?
Sorry, my computer actually just crashed there for like the last 5 to 10 minutes, so I'm not really sure what's going on.
Oh, okay.
Was it Rory, is it?
Yes.
Rory, we're just asking for the Gmail addresses so that, you know, you can have the links to the video session that was there. Recorded sessions and the content that will be shared to you via Sharon. You'll get those things. So if you can just share your Gmail address, so that would be helpful.
Thank you, Alex. Thank you, Tom. Hector, I got your email ID. I got Chandana as well. Ashra Binish, yes, I got theirs as well. I got Rashanka as well. So, Rory, you send your Gmail ID and I think I'll have that. That will complete. All right. So we'll conclude the session for today. Thank you all. I believe there are no further questions for Naveen.
Yeah, I guess so. Should I just get in touch with Rory and just take the email ID? I think
yes, rest all. Rory, you can send your Gmail ID to my email ID. I'll take it from there and then pass it on to the technical team to share the link for the recorded video session.
Yeah, you have pinged it to me. Sharon, I'll just ping you.